Thank you guys so much for coming to this. We know that it's warm in here and they are working on it. And we will be keeping these doors open either until it gets fixed or until it gets too noisy. So we'll be keeping our eye on that as well.
I agree.
So this is the tutorial on building a device lab. So if you meant to go to one of the other awesome tutorials and this is not yours, please feel free to exit now. We will not be locking the doors, so if you get really bored, you can also peace out. But this is going to be real fun. We're going to be singing a bunch, maybe dancing. For right now, I wanted to mention you can go on laraswanson.com/device lab and see all of these slides. There's about a million of them. They're broken up into each of the individual chapters that we'll be doing for the device lab. And I guess we can get started. All right, so this is a reminder. We will be talking about how to choose devices at the next point in this. So if you don't already, get out your visit traffic data to see what kinds of devices your visitors are using, and we'll use those to figure out what devices you should be purchasing for your lab. So what is Etsy? We both work at Etsy, and Etsy is a marketplace where creative people around the world connect to buy and sell unique goods. And there are two different types of engineering teams at Etsy. The first are feature teams, and these are the folks made up of like product managers and engineers and designers that work on our member-facing features, like the listing page and seller tools and the checkout process. And then there are us, and actually in this front row, I'm pretty sure every one of these fine folks are also on infrastructure teams at Etsy. I'm on the performance team. Destiny is on the security team. And there are plenty of other teams that support those feature teams in building out all those products. So we help make things faster. We help make their jobs more easy. And we help basically support them as they go and work on our member-facing features. So why did Destiny and I decide to build a device lab at Etsy? We originally estimated that we were going to hit 50% of traffic coming from mobile devices in like mid-2014, but we hit it super early this year in 2014. So this is the future for you too if you're not already there. I mean, go ahead and figure out when you're going to hit this number, but I mean, it's incredibly important to start building for this today. So we've built the device lab a number of times, and we were trying to figure out what minor version we're on now. We're on like 3.7, I think, of our device lab. Who has a device lab that looks like V1, the gray cabinet that's locked and full of dead devices? Yeah. Who has a device lab that looks like bookshelves, like this one in the middle? Nice. And who has a fancy pants device lab that has a 5-degree angle? And yeah, these guys. And that guy, who are you? You don't work at Etsy. Okay, great. So we wanted to empower our teammates, the people on the product teams, with ways to test all of their work on real physical devices. And so this was our goal throughout the process. We've iterated on it many times. Like I said, 3.7 is what we're on right now. And just real quick, our device lab by the numbers currently, we've got 36 devices that span 8 operating systems. We average about 45 users of the lab per month, and we have 4 median checkouts per device. I think this year so far, we've retired 8 devices, so they were broken, or something from them was stolen and it rendered them unusable, or we just couldn't use them anymore, they were really outdated. And we've purchased 12 new devices for the lab this year. Before we really get into it, we wanted to talk about privilege. We have a large engineering team and a budget for this, and we want to acknowledge that not everybody in the room is gonna have those things. So we very intentionally built this presentation around buying a device lab of any size, even a very small device lab. So we wanted to make sure it was clear here that we recognize our privilege and we wanted to make sure that the stuff was accessible to everybody. We also wanted to note usability. This is what works for us at Etsy, and it may not be what works for you. So we'll be providing examples from our lab, but they're not going to necessarily be what works for your team. So picture your team as your end users and make sure that you're regularly user testing and iterating on your device lab to be building what's best for them. So here's an outline of what we'll be covering today. We're going to start with 10 minutes on how to choose devices. Then we're going to spend the bulk of our time on power. This has probably been the biggest challenge for us, so we're going to spend a lot of time on it. Then how to set up devices, how to set up testing on those physical devices. We're going to cover networking and our use of RFID readers. And we're going to wrap up by talking about the user experience and organization of the lab, so making it as usable as possible for your coworkers. And in between each of these, we'll be taking questions. All right. So now we're going to talk about choosing devices.
Yeah.
So we're going to cover how to choose devices for your lab based on traffic to your site and what kinds of problems you may be using your lab to help troubleshoot. So let's start with finding this data. If you haven't already found which devices people use the most when they're visiting your site, open up Google Analytics. In here, there's the audience section, and then there's the mobile section, and then there's the devices section. And in there, you'll see something like this. It's a list of devices and various pieces of data about your traffic. In this case, I've also opened up a secondary dimension for operating system version. This is really helpful, again, in figuring out what devices you should be keeping in your lab and what versions they should be using. So I went through my personal site, and I tried to figure out what visitors were using when they visited the site. So we've got an iPhone, an iPad, another iPhone running an earlier version of iOS 7, some Android stuff, some more iPhones on various versions. I've gathered data about their operating system versions, the amount of traffic to the site, and also vaguely their size, a handset and a small or large tablet. So we want to focus on getting the most bang for your buck. We have 36 devices, and this is frankly an unnecessary amount of devices. We could probably get by with much fewer. Well, I'll get into the reasons why we have the devices that we have in a bit. But we really want to focus today on the 20% of the devices that produce the 80% of your traffic. So the top 10 devices listed here make up 74% of the total visits to my site. So this was a great starting list for me. Next, we want to talk about covering your visitors' screen sizes and operating systems. So in this case, as I look down the right, most of these are handsets. And then I've got the Apple iPad. It's really difficult to figure out if this is the iPad mini or the iPad, so I group them together here. And then the Google Nexus 7 is also a small tablet. This is also an opportunity to figure out if you have any particularly buggy devices in your list. We found that Kindles can be particularly buggy and also really old versions of Android. So be sure to go through this list and make sure that if you have them, that you've got them in your lab, because it's really important to test on them. In my list, nearly all of the iOS devices are running iOS 7, and the other devices are running recent versions of Android. So I don't have to worry so much about Kindles and older Androids in my case. You can rerun all of these reports by geographic location. So maybe you know that your primary user is located in the United States, or maybe they're located somewhere else. So maybe you have more data on your users, or maybe you have like age range or other demographic data that you would want to segment by. Go ahead and rerun these reports on devices based on your primary audience, and that can also help you narrow things down. Be sure to dig into the stuff before you buy any devices. If you have a lot of users on the Windows Surface or the Chromebook Pixel, be sure to test on a device that has a combination of touch and cursor. We have found some significant JavaScript issues, particularly in our navigation, that affected the ability for people to log into our site on the Chromebook Pixel. So we make sure that we have these devices in our testing lab. If you notice that a lot of people are using iPads or other devices with Retina screens, make sure you're testing on devices with a high DPI. All of the newer devices listed in this list are high DPI or classified as Retina, so I should make sure that I'm able to test things like how icons scale up on these screens. So what should I buy? If I buy one iPhone running iOS 7, that's 53% of my traffic. Then I could get an iPad to cover tablets, and then a Nexus 4 to cover Android handsets, and that's 72% of my traffic. That's pretty good coverage with just three devices. My next purchase will probably be an Nexus 7. All right, so how do we go about purchasing devices at Etsy? We found that we buy used devices to better represent what our users will actually experience as they're navigating our site. We can better represent battery life. In some cases, if we want to test cell signal strength, this is also really valuable. We don't really buy new devices unless we absolutely have to. We also consider whether or not we want a Wi-Fi capable device or something with a data plan, and we rarely, if ever, I can't remember the last time we bought something with a data plan. Most every time we buy it, because it's Wi-Fi, you don't really need to test anything over cell. Our only exception to this is one time we were measuring battery consumption based on cell signal strength, and in that case, we did buy a device specifically with a data plan so we could measure this, but this was absolutely an outlier. We buy our devices off of eBay, Amazon, and other local cell phone dealers. We will also buy things off of the Apple Store. We'll buy plenty of refurbished stuff. So what do we have in our lab? We've got 12 Android phones. this is actually really important for our lab because most of our engineers are iOS-based in that their personal devices are iOS devices, and they are really funny when they walk up to the lab and they see these Android devices and they're like, so how do I take a screenshot on this guy? So we have a lot of Android phones with a range of operating systems and different manufacturers to make sure we cover the spectrum. We also have 3 Android tablets with a range of screen resolutions to test responsive web designs. We've got 1 BlackBerry phone, the BB10. We recently this year retired our BlackBerry Bold because it just wasn't relevant anymore. We have a Firefox phone, and we have got 5 iPads, including 1 mini, and we have iPads 3, 4, and 5. 2, 3, 4. We have 5 iPhones and iPods. We have 1 Kindle Fire, 2 Kindle Fires, I'm sorry, with a range of screen resolutions. They're both HD. We retired our old Kindle Fire this year. We also have 1 Windows phone, 1 Windows Surface, and 1 Dell laptop. Most of this is actually for IE testing because we're mostly a Mac shop. People come over to the device lab and use our Windows laptops for testing IE. We also have a Google Glass and a Chromebook Pixel. These are mostly for the shine factor. People like to walk up to it and see our cool Google Glass and check it out. And we also have a Raspberry Pi and some Kubis. For those of you who don't know, a Kubi is this really cool little robot that can hold an iPad, and it helps our remote employees check out, you know, our offices and come and hang out with us virtually. If you go to laraswanson.com/device lab, you can see the links to these 2 articles that also talk about how to choose additional test devices. And with that, I'll open up for questions on choosing devices. Yes. What on earth is not set? Yeah, I mean, that could be a lot of different things. That just means like the beacon that Google Analytics got for you was not wholly intact, and there's not much you can do about it other than make sure that everything's firing and you're collecting the data back. There's 1 tough thing about mobile. So you're collecting front-end event logger data, and as it comes back to you over the wire, it can be packets can get lost. You can, like, everything gets corruptible, right? We find that with our visit traffic, we lose a lot more stuff over mobile than we do like over Wi-Fi or over laptop connections. So for us, we'll see something like that in our logs a lot too. Yeah, more questions? Yeah. Yeah, the question was, do we have a buyback program for employees in the office? And we don't. That's a really good idea. Definitely something we'll think about. Yes?
I apologize for coming in late and missing so much of it, but I'm not sure if
you only missed 1 jingle. It's okay.
I'm not sure if you covered this, but I didn't see on that list anything about all of the various watches, which are now available, some of which are going to be available in the near to distant future. And I know that our Android and iOS team has started accumulating all of the various watches, and
sure. So the question was about purchasing watches. So we get a lot of requests. In the last month, we've gotten requests for PlayStation and Xbox, a Tesla car, because you can now browse on Tesla. Right. Watches are absolutely big one we get requests for. We haven't looked into how to purchase watches yet. What we're probably going to do is wait until the market starts to use those and see where they're coming from. I'm going to guess the Apple Watch is going to be what we're going to get next. But no, I don't have any tips on how to buy them yet. Sorry. Yes?
You said you allow developers to check out devices. Does that ruin your testing infrastructure in any way?
Does allowing developers to check out devices ruin our testing, our infrastructure in any way? Yes. We're going to get a lot more into how to check out devices and also the surprises we've encountered because people check out devices in a little bit. But absolutely, I mean, it's a little bit tough knowing that devices will walk away and you both may never see them again, or people may actually install things on them that you don't want to, or that they're just not available for testing. So we try to keep really good track of where they are in the office, and we'll get into how we do that a little bit later. But yeah, it's definitely a risk in letting people walk away with them. Yeah, there's a question over here, yes.
I can answer that. So we've just been donating them. We have also a laptop donation program. So for any devices that we are just taking out of rotation, we end up trying to find a way to donate them.
Yes.
What do you do when a new version of an operating system is launched? Do you upgrade a number of devices or what?
So how do we handle upgrading devices? We will upgrade at least 1. So like when iOS 7 came out, we went through we chose which iPad we wanted to upgrade and upgraded just that one because people hadn't all moved over yet in terms of visit traffic, so we still wanted to test on iOS 6. When we hit, it was actually very quickly, iOS 7 adoption was super fast. We ended up adopting that pretty quickly across devices. It's been really hard also to prevent people from accidentally upgrading versions of the operating system. So for us, we've actually had to downgrade some because either people upgrade them accidentally or we just realize we're missing coverage of some version of some operating system. So it really depends. We mostly wait for visit traffic to get there, upgrade them all in a bunch, and then figure out whether or not we still need to retain older versions of an operating system version. Yeah. Yes. That's a good question. How do we forecast the budget of the device lab? It's been really hard because this is our second year of doing it. So we mostly looked at what had been in the locked gray cabinet previously. And then we also forecasted, like, the Nexus 7 came out, and then we knew some really fancy iPhone was going to come out, so we budgeted for those. And then mostly we've just been trying to figure out what people are most testing on, and that's been older Androids, which are actually not that expensive in like the $100 to $200 range for used versions of older Android. So for us, it was mostly just looking at those things in particular. So gauging what's probably going to come on the market, what people are probably going to be using based on past visit traffic, and then where any gaps are in our testing. Yeah. The other thing to add on to that is we've actually splintered into a number of different device labs now. So the one that we're talking about today is the main one for feature teams, but we also have individual device labs for our apps teams and also our QA team. That way they don't have to like worry about what's going to be checked in. They have their own dedicated ones where nobody's checking them out. It's just dedicated to those. So we've had to start budgeting for those labs as well. Yes. That's a great question. So it's really a question about performance. So what we've ended up doing is using like synthetic testing tools for testing most of our performance stuff. It's harder for me to talk about the apps stuff. We're just starting to look at performance in the apps. And this is all of this is built for the web. So the other device apps are for the app testing groups. So for us, because we've relied on synthetic testing for so long, we haven't need to worry about doing things over 3G. I imagine it's something we're going to tackle next year. Yeah.
Do you have remote engineers?
We do have remote engineers. That's a great question. So we realized that this was a problem for the first time this past year when we had our first Hack Week. We were encouraging people to work on things on mobile devices for their Hack Week, and we realized they have to just use their own dedicated phones, which is a problem. So we've started to look into how we can either work with different remote offices to staff them with like little labs, which is harder for us to manage remotely, or whether we should just give individual engineers the opportunity to like borrow a device for X period of time. We have yet to really figure this out. I don't think we have a good solution for that yet. But it's a problem that we've encountered, certainly. Yeah. More questions? That was super. Thanks, guys.
All right. Hello, everyone. I know it's after lunch, but the next subject we're going to talk about is power! Glam rock. One piece lame suit. Okay. You've acquired your devices, and you have your device lab started. You're building it, but you notice that some of your devices are acting weird, like not turning on. So powering your lab might seem simple, but we're going to spend most of the time on this topic because it can be really tricky, and we hope to save you a lot of time troubleshooting. So here's an example of what our power chain looks like. As you can see, the devices are plugged into either a power strip directly or to USB hub, which then get plugged into a timer. And then get plugged into a modlet. And the modlet actually is just a device that measures energy, and then that goes straight into the wall. We're going to delve down into the problems we ran into and how we resolve them, but first we're going to brush up on Electricity 101. So this might be really simple for some of you. We're trying to cover the widest audience that we can, from kind of absolute beginners like your grandmother to total pros. But here's some basic knowledge that'll help you avoid problems later on. So for the electricians in the room, I have to apologize for this analogy. It's the least worst analogy that we could come up with to get everyone to kind of understand how things work. So for our thought experiment, think of electricity like water flowing through a garden hose. And think of the garden hose as your cables that supply electricity to your devices. The two most common units of power that you're going to come across are going to be amps and volts. And understanding these units is important when figuring out how much power is needed to support the devices properly, and also in figuring out how many devices a particular hub or surge protector can support. So amperage, if we think back to the garden hose, this is the amount of water that's flowing through the hose in a given amount of time. In other words, it's how fast the electricity can reach its destination. And volts, think about that as water pressure. So the higher the pressure is, the faster the water can flow out. And what do you get when you multiply those together is watts. And that all makes sense because if you look at this example of a power brick for an iPad, it has an output voltage of 5.2 volts down in the bottom right, and the current is 2.4 amps. You multiply those together, you'll get 12 watts. So just kind of understanding how those all relate together can be really useful in determining whether an electrical panel can support more devices. Now that we understand a little bit about electricity, some other things to consider are how much power does each device draw? And so this is just really easy. You look it up according to the manufacturer's specs, look it up online, or sometimes it's with a box on the device. How much power can the surge protector support? Again, read this carefully, read the specs carefully, because a lot of times you'll get surge protectors that are not really surge protectors, or they'll just be a power extender and not actually support any kind of protection against surges. And how much power can each USB hub support? So the current for USB ranges from 100 milliamps to a maximum of 500 milliamps per port. And this is just an example, but a typical 7-port hub like this one might just have a 1-amp power supply that it comes with. So this is obviously not going to have enough power to drive a 500 milliamp load on every port. It would max out after 2 devices. And no other devices would work after that. So when you're choosing hubs, just make sure that you look at the specs and find out how many full load devices it can support. And in this example, I just want to point out that the two on the far right are the only two ports that would actually charge something. So make sure you look out for that as well. Another important thing is to build to support your most power-hungry devices. And I'll talk more about that in a moment, because if you don't, you can encounter all sorts of lovely problems. And you will encounter problems. So here are just a few examples of the problems that we encountered. More than half of our devices ended up having problems. So things like, you know, not turning on, turning on and off.
Someone stole the battery.
Yes. True story. So how do we fix it? And actually, as a side note, I should just point out that none of the problems were due to the devices being in used condition. So this is just an example of a Windows Surface. The other day, we had a Windows Surface that wasn't charging. And the employee who had it checked out did the smart thing. He tried plugging it into a different outlet across the room. It still wasn't charging at that point, so he looked up the manufacturer's specs and tried to go into their troubleshooting, do their recommended steps. None of those worked. And since the charger is proprietary, which is really annoying, we had to order a replacement charger in order to troubleshoot anything further. And the good thing is it turned out that it was just the charger that had died and the replacement ended up fixing it. But I'm telling you this because it all has to do with troubleshooting. And not to insult anybody's intelligence, again, wide audience range here. But troubleshooting's really hard. People really take it for granted. So I'm going to go over that a little bit. Can I get some audience participation and see what you would do, John Cowie, if your phone suddenly started not charging? Thank you, John. Yes. Ventriloquism. That's awesome. Yeah, so that's basic troubleshooting, but everybody kind of knows that innately. Oh, she said to try a new cable. So my first tip for advice is just to start simple. Start with the most simple and the most probable, because you can always dive deeper after this. And there's a fun saying that says, when you see hoof prints, look for horses, not zebras. So if your phone isn't charging, you're not going to have your electrician come rewire your apartment. You're not going to immediately buy a new phone unless you're rich. you could also probably first try a different outlet or swap out the cable. Secondly, you want to just isolate the problem. When you're isolating the problem, you only want to make one change at a time. So just substitute known good components one at a time. And in troubleshooting, you want to bisect it. So you've got the device. You want to then figure out if it's hardware or software that's causing the problem. Of course, this does require a little bit of understanding of the expected behavior and the problems that are being observed. But let's say you've just isolated the problem to the device itself. So that would be hardware. Well, these are some things that can cause problems in hardware. Cables can go bad. You can have a crappy battery. Or a lot of times people will think that the phone's or device isn't working, and it's just that the display has gone bad or the LCD is dead or something like that. And that's something that gets people a lot, which, you know, you end up taking the device apart or taking it to get repaired, and it turns out to be something completely different. And these are some problems that can occur on the software side. Obviously, the operating system can go bad. If you install apps on there, the apps can either corrupt the system or they can be crappy installs. Or your base image, if you're using some sort of a base image, that can be bad as well. Why? So the devices, the reason why we're having some of these problems is that devices would end up drawing too much power. Some devices just weren't getting enough power. We had bad USB cables, bad software, or a bad device. Certain devices like the BlackBerry Bold, we retired that, yeah. And the Galaxy Nexus drew too much power to be hooked up to the hubs, and we found out they had to be plugged directly into the outlet. And some of the USB cables were just bad, and we got them from someplace online that was mysterious, and we had to buy new ones. All right, so it can be expensive to iterate on power. Keep your receipts, definitely. And we went through four different versions of power solutions. Version one was just that the devices were plugged directly into the power strips. And these were just two 10-port Belkin surge protectors. And then those were plugged into a timer. And the timer just controlled what time the lab turned on and off each day. Version two was stupid USB hubs. These hubs, I can't even. They had like a toggle switch that was on and off at the same time. And so because it was attached to the timer, they wouldn't come back on when the timer started powering everything. It was just like a weird toggle switch. So that was irritating. We had to get a better solution. And these were better USB hubs that were self-powered. We ended up going with this hub made by Cambrionics. And this is ideal for lower power devices, because those are actually most of the devices we have in the lab. But it's not suitable for larger, more power-hungry devices like the iPad or other tablets. So tablets are generally going to require a higher charging level. So if you try to plug them into a hub like this, they're either going to charge really, really slowly or not power the device at all. And this hub was awesome. It ended up being able to handle up to 32 devices. And every port on this was powered to the maximum of the USB standard. There's also a safety precaution device within the circuit board that prevented a higher charge from going to each port. The little green light that you see on the right is the fault indicator light, which helps identify problematic devices. And devices that are consuming excess current are disabled, in that basically it leaves the non-faulty devices still charging. And in case you're wondering about the pink tape there, that's just an organizational technique that Laura is going to talk about later. Version 4, current version, is better cabling plus monitoring. So we just added in the modlet here, which I'll talk about in just a moment. And more organization, more cables. All right, so energy consumption. Naturally, we were curious about how much energy we were consuming in our lab. Etsy is a B Corporation, and in case you're not sure what that is, the best example I could come up with is that B Corp is to business is what fair trade is to coffee. So we take social responsibility seriously, and greenness really matters to us. This is a real photo. Not polished. So the devices are plugged into the timed power supply here, and that's only on between 10 a.m. and 6 p.m. on weekdays. And this is just obviously to help us make sure that they're alive for testing, but not hogging energy 24/7. And the modlet is what tells us how much energy we're consuming. This is a graph of the modlet data, and this comes out of the box. It's just super easy to set up, nothing special. But as you can see, it shows us at 10 a.m., we've got a spike there because all the devices are waking up and turning on. And then they slowly trickle down and end up around 25 watts. And then around, I guess, 6 p.m. is when we shut it off, so then drops off right there. It's just handy to know that. Pro tips. So hopefully with today's knowledge, you'll find that building your lab is fairly painless, but I wouldn't send you off without some tips. This hurts my brain. So standardize your cabling as much as possible. You're going to get a bunch of different devices that have a bunch of different power adapters. They're all going to be different. But standardizing, if you can, makes troubleshooting easier in the long run. And just know that not all cables are created equally. Some are weaker, some are more powerful. There are three different types of USB. And keep in mind that some devices you're just not going to be able to do this with. So you can just move on mentally from that because they're proprietary or something. Windows Surface. Yes, and have, if your budget allows for it, definitely have spare cables or even duplicate devices if it's something that is commonly used. Or very popular in your lab. And, more extra cables. Extra cables because they will go missing no matter what. Are there any questions about that, about power? Yes. Yes.
Where'd you buy the hub? Where'd you buy the USB hub?
On the interwebs.
Was it from the Cambrionics website?
You can get it from the website, I believe, directly, but we ordered it through our vendor. And I think it's also available on Amazon. Yes?
Why did you move to using a USB hub at all? Why not carry on with different power strips?
We ended up having a lot of different power strips. If you can imagine, just so many cables and so many things plugged into power strips, plus like having enough power strips with all the different bricks ended up it was like a space thing. So we thought if we got it as many things to go through a hub, it would streamline it more and make it better for everybody to use. Yep. You. So that's a really good question. I'm just going to ask you to pause on that because we're going to go into it in a couple.
Yeah. Mostly trust. I will say that. In terms of security, we have been surprised by the way people interact with our lab, certainly, but we mostly do trust that they're not going to just steal them. Although they do steal cables and we're just okay with it.
That's actually really interesting. Have we tested that? I don't think we have.
Not yet. We're planning on testing that, also turning on different times of day to see how much they are discharging over the weekend, to answer your first question. And then we're about to start experimenting with times of day that it's actually on. Do we need it on for our entire workday, or can it just be on for part of the workday, et cetera? So we'll be testing that.
Okay. Anyone else? Moving on. So the next thing we're going to talk about is
device setup.
You're welcome. Configuration is really important for your devices. How you configure your devices is going to be really important to the accuracy and success of your device lab and your testing environment. So while you want to replicate real-life scenarios, you don't want to start with a device that's buggy or doesn't have the software that you need for testing. So for your base image, you always want to start by doing a factory reformat. This is especially helpful if you're getting a used device and you purchased it from a bum off the street. You don't know what's happened to it. Just factory reformat it. Most devices have a way to just reset them to factory standard, like on the device itself. If you can't figure that out, you can usually just do it through a wired USB connection to the computer. And that's just going to delete everything on the phone that exists. Any data, any apps. And it also helps in bypassing a lock code because of the one that the homeless guy put on there. So you also want to disable auto updates. We turned off auto updates and auto upgrades, both on the apps and the OS. That's handy because when you're testing a specific release, obviously you don't want somebody to change it and ruin that part of it. We disabled system update notifications as well. That way, just kind of, if the next person picks up the device, they wouldn't see that prompt and feel the need to update. This is really important. Just create an App Store account. Use one email address across all of your devices. And you might be wondering why you even need an email address at all. You're going to need it for downloading apps from the native app stores. And if you need certain apps for testing, many of them are going to require a login associated with an email account. So just make it easy on yourself and keep it all in one email account. And then install whatever apps you need. We installed Adobe Edge Inspect on all of our devices. Laura's going to talk to you in depth about that, but it lets you run the same test on multiple devices simultaneously. Restrict devices from syncing to computers. Again, this is to prevent accidental upgrades or changes to the system. And you might not be able to do this for every device, but if you can, you should. And then make use of the browser default homepage. We set ours to Etsy.com so that we could easily test how our website looks through the mobile browser. Make use of the wallpaper. This is ours. It just says, you know, sign me out and don't touch anything. And how to reach us in case you need help. It's also good for just at-a-glance information and policies. Setting up a passcode is really important as well. Prevents just anyone from being able to use the device, and this is important since the devices have access to our testing and staging environment. And the passcode, again, should be the same on all devices. Having a way to identify your devices is really important. If you can, give each device an asset tag or some sort of physical identifier. This LG Optimus here has a scannable asset tag, and you can see it's 2386. So that actually matches up with the label on the shelf, so people can just know exactly where to return that to. And if it's possible to change the default device name on the device itself, make it a name that's easy to identify on your network. Having a backup image is really important. If the software gets changed or broken somehow, you want to have an easy way to get it back to your original configuration. MDM, mobile device management, is important. It's something that we are in the really kind of beginning stages of. We're using AirWatch right now, and we've enrolled a lot of our devices in it, and just kind of, if you don't know what an MDM is, it's basically a software that your company can use to monitor and manage and support your mobile devices that you have. It can also be used as BYOD, which means bring your own device. And that means that you can manage company data on the personal devices of your employees. And that's great because it operates independently of mobile operators and service providers. So instead of setting up and maintaining your devices manually, which can be super time consuming, you can have an MDM kind of do all this work for you over the air. When you're looking at choosing your MDM, there are a ton out there. Obviously, AirWatch, as I mentioned. There is also Apple Configurator. And there is also Google Device Google something mobile device management as well, which I just found out about. And yeah, so let's go over the important features of what to pay attention to when you're choosing your MDM. Scalability, most often used word here at this conference. So does it have location-specific admin options? Obviously, you want it to be able to grow alongside your company. Does it have failover capability or load balancing? When it comes to app management, does it let you push app configuration? Can it pull app feedback or data from the devices? And also, can you separate managed and unmanaged data?